the first thing I want you to know just is just how very happy I am to be here. I have some friends from St. Louis who came down for this occasion, and one of them got me a card that reminds me of the august occasion and puts it in perspective. So the inside of my card says, "Congrats, congratulations." And the outside says, "You're the lone corn dog in a world of plain wieners." So I want you to know that, at least for this week, I am pleased to be your corn dog. I do want you to know what a great honor you've granted me and the pleasure with which I look forward to serving the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. I would like us to spend a few minutes reflecting on the theme verses for this General Assembly, Philippians 3, 13 to 14. The people who have served us so well by putting together this General Assembly have chosen these verses for a reason. So let's please read together. Paul writes in Philippians, "Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own." I did not expect that. That was wonderful. Thank you so much. Give yourself a round of applause. So I want to remind you of some truths that are here. And when I say remind you, I realize that probably about two-thirds of you have either taught or preached on these verses, and therefore you know them far better than I do. But I believe that there is a message in these verses for our General Assembly. And I would like to give you what I believe that message to be in a nutshell. First, I want you to know that this is the God logic of the Christian life. That in Christ, we are to be freed from our past, assured of our future, and focused on this moment, and moving forward. So let's look at this passage and see if this is true. So Paul starts off with the statement, "Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own." So Paul first addresses us as brothers and impliedly sisters too. He speaks to us as one of us. Paul describes us as running a race, and he is running the race right alongside of us as a brother. And then he says, "I do not consider that I have made it my own." So what is the "it" that he says he has not yet made his own? Well, from verse 12, immediately preceding our verses, we see that he is talking about perfection. Paul is telling us that he is not perfect. He says, "I do not consider that I have made perfection my own." But Paul is not content to stay where he is. And in order to move ahead, some proper forgetting is necessary. Our past lives can paralyze us from moving forward in our Christian lives. But Paul says we need to move on. Paul says, "One thing I do, forgetting what lies behind." Well, there are some things that we should not forget. We are not to forget lessons that we have gained from experience, which have given us godly wisdom. We are not to forget God's past faithfulness to us, which gives us hope for the future. So what are we to forget? We are to avoid dwelling on anything in our past which hinders our present effort and our future progress. So, for example, we are not to allow ourselves to be consumed by past glories. Just a few verses before this, Paul reminds us that he was an Israelite. He was from the tribe of Benjamin. He was circumcised on the eighth day. He was zealous for faith, and he was blameless under the law. Paul had reasons to be proud. But he said that these past glories were as nothing, as rubbish, compared to knowing Christ. Then neither are we to despair over our past sins. Paul elsewhere calls himself the chief of sinners, the foremost of sinners, the worst of sinners, but he will not allow any of these things to disqualify him from ministry. Then Paul reminds us that Christians are to live in a way that is unique. That is because our future is secure in a way that no other people can claim. Paul says, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Among the commentators, there is some difference of opinion about what Paul means by the prize of the upward call. Some people understand that Paul is talking about the prize that is won in this life by pressing through life situation after life situation over the course of the Christian life. Others understand Paul to be talking about the prize of eternal life, which is ours after death. I think the best understanding, though, is that Paul intentionally left this undefined to encompass all aspects of the future. But Paul's primary point is that the upward call is sure and certain. And we know this because this is God's call. God's call which comes to pass because in Christ we are secure. And all of God's promises find their yes in Christ. So therefore, neither our past, which is behind us, nor our future, which is assured, should hinder us. And that leaves us with the meat of the sandwich. We are to be straining forward. We are to be pressing forward. Because God has freed us of the past and assured our future, we are free to focus on the moment and look forward. And Paul says this is the normal pattern for the Christian life. In verse 3:15, immediately after our passage, Paul says, let those of you who are mature think this way. Now, if you think about it for a little while, we see this pattern repeated over and over in Scripture and in all of Christian history. We see God call Abraham out of Ur. And in response, Abraham went to the promised land. We see Ruth follow God's call to go with Naomi. And Ruth became a link in the chain that brings us our Savior. We see Peter leave his nets to follow Christ and become a fisher of men. We see William Carey leave the cobbler's bench in England to go and tell the gospel in India. Now, none of these things happened without great difficulty. Fearful Abraham had a habit of calling his wife Sarah his sister. Ruth had to overcome Naomi's objections before she could move forward. Peter had a propensity to tell Jesus what Jesus could and could not do, but he left his nets and embraced the fullness of the gospel. William Carey spent 7 years in India before he had his first convert, but he moved forward. If you want to see a good example of this lived out in our memories, reread Dr. Martin Luther King's Mountaintop speech. That was the speech that he gave in Memphis downtown 50 years ago this year. He gave it on the night before he died. And if you look at that speech, this seems to be the pattern of Dr. King's life. So in the beginning of that speech, Dr. King said that if God had asked him when he wanted to live, given him a choice of any era, he could have lived in, perhaps in ancient Egypt, Dr. King says, or in ancient Greece, or in the glories of Rome, or in the Renaissance. And he talks through a number of periods in which Dr. King could have lived. Dr. King said, no, I would want to live exactly in the time that I'm living, at the end of the 20th century, Dr. King was not interested in past glories. Dr. King also, toward the end of his speech, said that he was aware of the death threats against him. But he had been to the mountaintop, and he had seen the glory of the Lord, and he wasn't afraid of any man. His future was assured. No, Dr. King said, I'm happy to be right here in Memphis working on the sanitation workers' strike because God is at work in Memphis. So let's talk about us. Do you see your past behind you? Do you see your future assured? And therefore, are you reaching, stretching, pressing forward, forward? Let me ask, do you see God at work where you are? Do you see God at work in Orlando, Florida? Do you see God at work in Houston, Texas, and New Orleans? Do you see God at work in Ottawa, Kansas? In Port Gibson, Mississippi? In Roseville, California? This General Assembly has been planned with the intention that each one of us, no matter where we're serving, would be encouraged to move forward. So you have heard from and you will hear from speakers who we hope will broaden your horizons. We'll praise God together in music, in preaching, in communion. We'll study God's word together. We'll pray, we'll fellowship, we'll work together for the good of our denomination. I want to ask for just a moment that we pray together. I'm going to introduce some topics that are along the lines of what you've heard in the last 5 minutes, and I'm going to leave then some awkward silences. And I'm going to ask then that you would bring that prayer to bear on your own situation, where you are as an individual, as a member of your family, in your community, and our churches and denominations. So let me ask you, please, the old corn dog would like to lead us in prayer. Lord, some of us need to leave behind our past, whether glorious or ignominious. We ask, please, that you would show each one of us here tonight what we need to leave behind. And we ask you, please, to help us do that. So please pray for that individually. Then there are some of us who need to feel assurance of the future. We are anxious about what lies ahead, and we need to know that you have us in your hand, that you are good, that you are powerful, and that you take care of your children. And so, Lord, if we harbor fears about the future, we ask that we could please turn them over to you very specifically. And now, Lord, we ask you to show us where we need to press forward. Help us, Lord, to be people who draw close to you and who are conformed to your image increasingly over our Christian lives. Help us to get rid of our tempers and to hold our tongues and to avoid covetousness and all the rest. Lord, we pray that you would be drawing families together, our own families, that you would be building godly relationships within each home represented here. And we pray, Lord, now for our neighborhoods, our schools and workplaces, so that we might be a blessing to others. We pray for our churches, that you would help us to draw people to Christ and to grow disciples. And then finally, Lord, we pray that you would use these several days that we're together, and the next year in our denomination, the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, we ask for wisdom to help us follow you as your people. And we pray all these things in your name. Amen. Would you humor me for a moment and just stand for a moment? Okay, I hope that we can sort of memorize the gist of these verses. So I'm going to ask my friend Jeff Jeremiah, and I'm going to start us off through these verses. And I'm going to ask Jeff then to lead you, and you're going to echo them back to me, okay? So this is like the mostly white version of call and response. It would be done much better someplace else. So you ready? Brothers and sisters.
Brothers and sisters.
Forgetting what lies behind.
Forgetting what lies behind.
I press forward, forward, forward.
I press forward, forward, forward.
For the upward call of God in Jesus Christ.
In the upward call of God in Jesus Christ.
Okay, let's try it once more. You ready? Brothers and sisters.
Brothers and sisters.
Forgetting what lies behind.
Forgetting what lies behind.
I press forward, forward, forward.
I press forward, forward, forward.
We press forward, forward, forward.
We press forward, forward, forward.
For the upward call of God in Jesus Christ.
To the upward call of God in Jesus Christ.
You may be seated. Thank you very much.
Amen.